Good morning, and we'll call to order the meeting of the Regional Transportation Commission of Southern Nevada. Ms. Quigley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. Your first item is your agenda, and it is in order and ready for your approval.
Motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Your second item is to receive the General Manager's Report, and we do have a few items for you today. Our first item is our superstar of the quarter. We, on a quarterly basis, like to recognize an RTC employee, and this quarter's superstar is an asset not only to her division, but also to all of the RTC. Applying her knowledge of finance and safety and security, Jacqueline Lombardo of Human Resources has been instrumental.
Jacqueline come down, Lombardo, Jacqueline. Come on down.
She has been instrumental in assisting with the setup of current evaluation systems used by the HR department. She's provided valuable insight to improving our training programs and recruitment process. And her mind is always focused on making the RTC better. Jacqueline treats others' concerns and issues as her own, and she goes above and beyond to assist anyone in whatever way that she can. She also brings a great sense of humor to the job. For these reasons, Jacqueline is highly valued, and she is this month's superstar.
No, I just want to say thank you to whoever nominated me. I love working for the RTC. Every day is a blast. Thank you.
All right, stay up, because now I'd like to take a moment to recognize an employee of our safety and security contractor, Allied Barton. While on shift at the Bonneville Transit Center, Officer Paul Strong.
We have Paul with us today?
Paul Strong, come on down. He observed a juvenile alone around 1 a.m. in the morning. He, along with another officer, approached a young boy who turned out to be only 10 years old. Turns out the young boy had been home alone and hungry, so he decided to leave his house to find food. He was lost, but fortunately he wandered to the BTC. Officer Strong alerted the proper authorities and kept the boy safe and calm while waiting for Metro and Child Protective Services to arrive. Please congratulate Officer Paul Strong.
I just want to say thank you, and every day seems to be a challenge working at Bonneville Transit Center, and we just try to make the best out of it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'd also like to recognize an employee from our fixed route contractor, John Brown. Do we have John Brown with us? John Brown, a transit supervisor from Keolis. Come on down, John. He's being recognized today for a special service that he provided to an individual in need of help. While on duty at the South Strip Transfer Terminal, John struck up a conversation with a young man who was stranded in Las Vegas after leaving his California home without his parents' knowledge. John phoned the young man's parents, arranged for a bus ticket home, provided him with food and water, and ensured that security was aware of the situation and would not expel him from the terminal. He also made sure the young man boarded the bus safely and stayed in touch with his family until his safe return home.
I would just like to say thank you so much for the recognition from the Board of Commissioners, from the RTC, and from my employer, Keolis Transit America. Thank you so much.
Thank you. John. we have one more recognition. We'd like to recognize from our fixed route operator, MV Transportation, Gonzalo Contreras. Gonzalo, are you here? Yeah. One down. Gonzalo is a driver who is always willing to go the extra mile. Last month, he assisted another MV operator who was involved in a serious accident with a drunk driver. Gonzalo immediately secured his coach on the other side of the street and ran over to ensure the well-being of the driver and passengers. Gonzalo then called 911 and waited until his fellow operator was in control of the accident scene before he proceeded on his route. His concern for the safety of his colleague and the RTC's clients deserves our acknowledgement and appreciation.
Okay, well, I would just like to say thank you for the recognition, and it's always a pleasure to come to work for MV. There's always something going on new, and you have to keep up with the pace. Just thank you.
And you can have a seat. That's the end of our recognitions. Next, we'll have Tamara Williams, who's Director of HR Safety and Security, for our to give you a safety and security update. You asked us a while ago to give you regular updates as to our efforts to keep our drivers safe, and we have got Tamara here.
This is T2. T2, yeah. That's right.
Oh, that's right. Is that too long?
Okay. Okay, good morning, Chairman and members of the board. As a reminder, in 2014, the board gave the RTC direction to review and evaluate security concerns. We conducted a peer review of transit agencies, and we met with operators to obtain feedback. You then approved an increase of approximately $4 million to the overall security budget. This allowed us to add approximately 73 additional officers to increase the overall security presence on our transit system. We also merged security contract dispatch with bus operations center at both yards to enhance better communication and response. In 2010, RTC had one security response vehicle and the response time was approximately 1.5 hours. As part of the security enhancements, we added 6 additional rapid response vehicles, which now averages a response time of approximately 16 minutes. This has resulted in approximately 78% decrease in the overall security response time. You'll see that while our ridership has increased, the number of assaults on board has decreased. Ridership has increased approximately 3.2% and assaults have decreased approximately 6%. Driver safety enclosures. Similar to other transit agencies across the country, the RTC reviewed and evaluated the installation of driver safety enclosures. We conducted a pilot test of the driver safety enclosures, and based on driver feedback, slight modifications were made. Installation of the safety enclosures began this month with an anticipated completion date by the first quarter 2016. Here's a quick video to update the board on the driver safety enclosures to include feedback from one of our operators.
The RTC will be installing 250 security doors on our fixed route transit vehicles to help address the safety concerns of operators. The security doors will be installed on 40-foot, 60-foot, and double-deckers. Some of the features for the new door include durable construction, sliding glass windows, and two-stage locks. All new Excelsior vehicles will already have the security doors installed with the build-out.
New security door does make me feel safer. And the reason why it makes me feel safer is because it's secure during the day, and I know I'm secure during the day and the night from any potential harm being done to me. I love most about it is the first word, security. It gives me security and peace of mind for my own safety and the safety of other operators. I normally drive the Rainbow 101 route. Also, I drive the 901 and the 902, which is the airport buses. I love working with people, and I love to drive. From the customer perspective, They generally like the door because they also worry about the safety of the operators. So it's a bit or more, they like the security of the door for the drivers.
Members of the board, that concludes my presentation. I'm open for any questions.
Thank you. Comments or questions? Well done.
Thank you.
They might be letting you off easy.
Next, you asked us to come back on a quarterly basis to give you an update on our Southern Nevada Strong progress. And so I'm going to turn it over to Raymond Hess, our Director of Planning, to give you an update on Southern Nevada Strong.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. So over the last several months, we've been working meticulously with all the regional partners, as well as internally our staff, as well as a consultant helping us with this effort, to really map out our strategy moving forward to make sure that we're aligning our resources most effectively to implement Southern Nevada Strong. So we're proud to report that over the last several months, we've had numerous one-on-one meetings with each of the regional partners to both identify our vision of moving Southern Nevada Strong forward into implementation, as well as identifying what the resources are needed out there by our regional partners. We've also held several lunch and learns. There's one that was held back in June where we had Maricopa Association of Governments as well as Wasatch Front Regional Council come out and talk to us about best practices from a Metropolitan Planning Organization. And we're really excited about next month's lunch and learn, which will feature Robert Grove from Envision Utah. Envision Utah is recognized as a national leader in effective regional planning, and he'll come out and really tell us about how to effectively advance a regional planning effort such as Southern Nevada Strong and how we can effectively engage the public in this effort moving forward. We've engaged our stakeholders through several other workshops as well. We had a transit-oriented development workshop that was conducted by the National Transit Institute at the end of October. We had several local jurisdictions attend that. We have another transit-oriented development workshop lined up in early December, where we're going to have peers from Salt Lake City, Nashville, and the Minneapolis-St. Paul area come to us and talk about how they implemented their transit-oriented development programs. As many of you are aware, transit-oriented development is kind of key towards Southern Nevada Strong because it really is that perfect marriage between land use and transportation planning, and it really can effectuate the change that's called for in the Southern Nevada Strong Regional Plan. Some of the other kind of workshops that we've done, which are kind of unique, is we hosted Environmental Protection Agency as well as the US EPA. A couple months ago to sit down with our regional partners and say, you know, what are some of the resources that the federal agencies can bring to bear? What are some of the obstacles that the local agencies are experiencing? And what kind of technical assistance or resources can those federal agencies provide to our local jurisdictions? We had a really good dialogue, and we chronicled all that in our meeting notes, and we're going to advance those and follow up with those in the future as well. Another good example of kind of our role as core administrator is there was a food recovery workshop that was held at the end of October, which was really
another word for compost.
Right? Yeah, which is a good word for compost. So, and you know, I gave a presentation at the beginning saying, you know, you might be wondering why the RTC is holding a composting workshop, but it really talks about kind of our new role with Southern Nevada Strong, that we're the facilitator, we're really going to be one of the conveners of these efforts. So while we are not going to necessarily get into the composting business, there's probably a joke there to be made, but while we're not going to get into the composting business, there's an opportunity for us to bring together other regional partners around a certain subject. And so this subject was EPA and NDEP wanted to come in and talk about, you know, some of the food waste that we experience in the valley and ways that it might be recovered for composting and reuse in the future. One of our most recent accomplishments, which we're very excited about, is we reconvened what was called the Consortium Committee, which is now the Steering Committee for Southern Nevada Strong. It brings together all of our regional partners. We're very excited to have Councilwoman Deborah March as our chair, and Commissioner Chris G as our vice chair, representing SNRPC and this commission. And so we had a meeting just 2 weeks ago, I believe, and then the next meeting is scheduled for next Thursday. And so we're going to use this committee not only as kind of a guiding force for Southern Nevada Strong moving forward, but also as a learning lab. We want to use the opportunity to learn from one another about some of the successes that are working and how we can use that for positive change in the future. So we are gonna come back to you quarterly, and every quarter we hope to bring up one of our regional partners. And so it's my pleasure to introduce Jennifer Duty, Director of Public Works for the City of North Las Vegas, to talk to you about some of the exciting things that are happening in City of North Las Vegas related to Southern Nevada Strong.
Good morning. I'm happy to be here in front of you to highlight some of the projects and programs that we're doing in North Las Vegas. And one of the core areas for Southern Nevada Strong is our downtown city center. In January, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development awarded a $485,000 Choice Neighborhood Planning Grant to the city. This grant will help the city craft comprehensive, locally driven plans to revitalize and transform the public housing in the distressed neighborhoods of Rose Garden and Buena Vista Springs. Downtown North Las Vegas is one of four opportunity sites that were mentioned in the Southern Nevada Strong Regional Plan. And this grant will go a long way to help revitalize these two neighborhoods. We are also working with HUD on the Neighborhood Networks Program, which provides a wide range of services to residents in the area to achieve long-term economic self-sufficiency. Several transportation projects are currently underway, which will realize the Southern Nevada Strong goal of increasing transportation choice. There are plans to retrofit both Cary Avenue and Las Vegas Boulevard to come up to complete street standards, which will provide multimodal opportunities along those corridors, in addition to providing safe pedestrian walkways to help the residents in the area to be able to go from home to work to school to shopping. The city was also provided a grant from the Southern Nevada Health District that we are using to compile local complete street policy and to install bike lanes in our downtown core as well. Creating a sense of place is important to complete communities, and the city of North Las Vegas has several projects to beautify the downtown area. North Las Vegas, in conjunction with the National Parks and Recreation Association, revitalized and renovated Joneep Park in September, which is in our College Park neighborhood of downtown North Las Vegas. We also have an extensive graffiti abatement program that we have recently rolled out that has gone to great strides to reduce the graffiti problem that we had in our downtown core. And in 2016, an art program will pilot using our traffic signal boxes as canvas for different artworks in the downtown area. And we're also looking to partner with our local schools to come up with an art mural program that we can install on restrooms and other blank surfaces in some of our parks and downtown areas. These are just a few examples of some of the exciting things that we are doing to implement the Southern Nevada Strong Regional Plan. And we look forward to continuing to work with the RTC to come up with other ways to make Southern Nevada stronger. Be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, and congratulations on the Choice Grant. That was really something I think that was triggered through the four opportunity grants that we had. So good job. I just want to point out, and this isn't just for you, we adopted a plant list years ago so that everybody in the valley should be looking at plants that really do affect the cooling as well as add to the atmosphere, the oxygen, and so forth. And I always notice on people's drawings that they're still putting palm trees. Palm trees are not indigenous to Las Vegas. They are at the bottom of the list. They should be the last use rather than something that cools. So hopefully, as anybody is moving forward on redesign, including RTC, cities, Charleston just put palm trees up, we really should be cognizant of why we did a regional plan with the School of Architecture, with the School of Landscaping, who really spent some time trying to come up with what was the best type of source to be able to make sure that we're improving the community. So I just point that out because your drawings had some palms in there. So use it as an opportunity. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Any other questions on the hybrid palms?
Well, I'd just like to compliment both of you on your presentations, and it's nice to see these Southern Nevada Strong presentations coming to the RTC board as the MPO for Southern Nevada. It really does raise and elevate the importance of the things that we're doing in our communities that really implement these policies and practices. So I compliment both of you, and you know, it is exciting to be part of this transformation that's occurring, whether it's composting or conversations about so many other things. We're really changing the way Southern Nevada does business, and whether it's transit-oriented development or land use decisions or whatever. You guys just have our praise, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Commissioner.
Thank you. I love the idea. We've been doing the ZAP projects. The city did some with us in the county, and we call it that in the county, but for the traffic boxes and the electrical and so forth. As you move towards that, I don't know if you need assistance with how we do the juries for selecting, because we all try to get local artists that are there. Mm-hmm. Please, I would offer up, if our folks don't mind, but our Michael Ogilvie, who we stole from the city of Las Vegas, does our arts, heads up our arts commission, but Patrick Gaffey over at Winchester actually started the original project in 2000, I think. So that I just offer that as some resources to maybe help you. I love the idea. We've been using students through our Summer Business Institute to do the murals along the wash and things along those lines as well. So that I encourage that, because there is true art that can be done in those areas, and it does beautify the area. So congratulations on that part.
Thank you. And it also cuts down graffiti too, so it's a win-win, definitely.
Gotta coat it though, that new stuff.
Definitely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I'll just comment that, and not to be a sycophant and complete suck up, but I do feel like it's because of the leadership of the board that we've got right now. So we're really excited about the Southern Nevada Strong effort, because we really believe it's going to generate conversations, just like you brought up, Commissioner G and Councilwoman March, about collectively having these conversations. And it's only because you guys have believed in this and pushed it, staff believes in it and is pushing it too, that collectively it really has the opportunity to make a difference and get the ball rolling, get the momentum behind it, and really truly make Las Vegas, Southern Nevada, a different place to live. Speaking of which, really great people who are helping to make Southern Nevada a better place to live, I would like to ask Mauricia Baca, who's the executive director of Outside Las Vegas Foundation, come and give a presentation to our board regarding their activities and partnership with the RTC.
Thank you so much, Tina, and thank you, board. It's an honor and a pleasure to come before you, so thank you so much for this opportunity. As Tina mentioned, I'm Mauricia Baca. I'm the executive director for the Outside Las Vegas Foundation. Next. Oh, excellent, fantastic. I have my own ability to do that. Mm-hmm. All right. Outside Las Vegas Foundation, the concept behind the organization, for those who aren't familiar with us, is the idea of enjoy, value, protect, that continuum. A lot of it fits with Southern Nevada Strong, that you have to enjoy our wonderful outdoor places to move towards that point where you value them, and then you take those next steps of protecting them, and that can take many different forms. Now, the Outside Las Vegas Foundation has actually been around since 2000, and it's evolved. In its first 10 years, I'd say its focus was very much on facilitating processes, open space planning processes, and really working together with all of the jurisdictions, everybody sitting here, and many others, to bring these together. As I came on board with the organization in 2010, it became apparent we have spectacular resources, really a phenomenal community, but what we really needed to do is work very directly towards connecting that community to these spectacular resources and creating that engagement and that sense of involvement in these resources, really going towards that quality of life and bringing us to that next level, I think, again, fitting in with that Southern Nevada Strong sort of concept. Our organization works to connect our community through efforts that involve health and wellness, education, community engagement, and regional collaboration, all of these working within our outdoor spaces. Now, health and wellness, we do this through a number of different efforts. Many of you are familiar with Neon to Nature, the new app, for instance, that was launched in collaboration with the Southern Nevada Health District. Information for that was collected through work with the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group, and all of that collaborative effort came together to launch that. Outside Las Vegas Foundation does things such as hosting a meetup group where we invite people to explore their urban trails. Many times people aren't as comfortable doing this on their own. So it ranges from younger folks to senior groups who maybe aren't as comfortable with exploring these trails, and making it something that is something really approachable and accessible so that they can take that on into the future and make it part of their lives. We were also involved with something called the Let's Get Healthy in Nature Initiative, where we worked with our federal partners with this idea that the easiest prescription you can write is to put on a pair of shoes and go for a walk. It's something that you can incorporate into your everyday life. And that's where our open space and trail system really does contribute in so many ways to our community and the integrity and vitality of our community. We also are involved with efforts that involve education. I think this may be something that many people here may be somewhat less familiar with what we do. The organization was asked to lead something called the Children Outdoor Bill of Rights Alliance. As part of that process, we became aware that there was a really strong need for transportation, fabulous places, wonderful groups of kids and schools that wanted to get to those places, but the connection that was missing was that transportation. We started focusing on writing micro grants, writing larger grants, and then distributing those as micro grants. As a result, we began that program in February 2012. Since that time, we've been able to get over 8,000 young people out on field trip opportunities, mostly with a focus on lower income and at-risk youth who might not otherwise have those opportunities. So those micro grants have gone to Clark County School District teachers, working with After School All-Stars, Big Brothers Big Sisters, Boys and Girls Clubs, a variety of different organizations and efforts, things even involving the Partnership for Homeless Youth and the Embracing Project, to really look at different ways to engage people in the healing experiences and the educational opportunities of those outdoor experiences. We've funded to date 179 buses through those microgrant programs, generously supported by groups such as NV Energy, Barrick Gold of North America, and the Wells Fargo Foundation. And we do outreach programs where we go to various places to introduce the Mojave and our outdoor places. We've introduced roughly 45,000 people through those programs to these outdoor places. We do a lot of the time we focus on that science, technology, engineering, and mathematics spectrum and the way that you can involve our outdoor places in that educational spectrum. We've been most recently involved in doing things like working with teachers to develop curriculum that can be incorporated into the classroom so that our trails, our open spaces can actually be used as outdoor classrooms and making it something approachable for teachers so that they can work that into their Common Core standards that they need to work with. Community outreach. We recently also worked with the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group, part of the Southern Nevada Regional Planning Coalition, to create the regional trail map. This is a new map that brought together all of our cities and wonderful places. Previous to that, you had to download or look for information in many different places. Now, the city of Las Vegas, North Las Vegas, Clark County, city of Henderson, and city of Boulder City are all placed on one map so that as people look for their outdoor experiences, they can do that either in that one map format or through the app. We find that people still like both. People often like to be able to open up a map and really get that sense of where everything is placed in the world, so they come together. The Vegas Valley Rim Trail is another one of our project areas that many of you are aware of that will one day encircle the valley, and actually much of which has already been completed through the collaborative efforts of all of our jurisdictions. I'm mentioning the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group, which is that really wonderful group of partners that have come together. We facilitate that, and it's been an honor and a pleasure to facilitate that group. Really fantastic professionals that get together and work to make sure that the trails are coordinated, now working on things like ensuring that we have maybe a better presentation of information about permitting as we have larger groups that want to come and involve and get involved on events on our trails, looking at more at a more coherent signage process and things along those lines to make it really accessible to people. It's one thing to build it, it's another thing to get people onto the trails and using it in a way that's very user-friendly. And then Get Outdoors Nevada Day, which we were lucky enough to take Get Outdoors Nevada Day on. It was a transition from the Southern Nevada Trails Day that had been held for so long by our wonderful partners in the city of Henderson. Get Outdoors Nevada Day is now rotating through all the different jurisdictions. Last year it was held at the city of North Las Vegas as our first partner. We had about 2,000 people in attendance at Craig Ranch Regional Park. This year it was held on October 24th at Sunset Park with Clark County as our partner. We had almost 3,000 people in attendance. Really fantastic, and again, it's a celebration of what we have as our community. A lot of what we focus on is celebrating the spectacular things that we have here in our community, because we do have a lot to, I think, that tells a great story. One of the things I wanted to focus on when I'm coming here before this group in particular is our community engagement and volunteerism program. In 2011, we began our first effort with the city of Las Vegas. We were approached to help engage the community. There were such spectacular trails, and there was really an interest in getting people out onto those trails and getting them engaged and involved with those trails in a more creative way. So the city of Las Vegas had this idea of starting an Adopt-a-Trail program, and we worked with them to develop that program. In 2013, we added in a layer with that program, and we were asked by the Southern Nevada Agency Partnership, which is all the four regional partners, to take on their Get Outdoors Nevada website, which is a website, where a portal, if you will, for outdoor volunteer experiences. So we took that on, and we added into that any outdoor volunteer experience that there might be in the valley. In 2014, we were able to expand our program to include the city of North Las Vegas and Clark County, and that has really seen an expansion. We find that when people say that people don't volunteer here, it's not true. People in our area deeply and truly want to volunteer and help out. They just want that opportunity. So what we do is we really enhance the ability of our city and jurisdictional partners to create those opportunities. That's what we focus on. Here you have with the city of Las Vegas, and if I have my cheat sheet in front of me over here, the city of Las Vegas, again, I mentioned that program just began with our first event, went on the ground in February 2012. Since then, we've had 9,625 volunteer hours through 66 events. Our biggest limitation has really been having the number of people to handle these events. People just want to get out there. Groups range from MGM, Wynn, Sands, Wells Fargo, churches, Eagle Scouts, all different types of corporate groups, small businesses, large businesses, all wanting to engage on our trails. The city of North Las Vegas, no, sorry, Clark County, I went to Clark County. Clark County, we just began with them in 2015. And since the first events that we began, we've had 14 events with 1,803 volunteer hours. Again, a tremendous interest, ranging from going to smaller parks to working at the Sunrise Trailhead, where we've had collaborative efforts with Clark County, the Bureau of Reclamation, the Bureau of Land Management, to really affect some change and doing things, not just going up and doing cleanup, but holding community meetings as well. We did that in partnership with Commissioner June Culiani, really looking at engaging the community and the idea that these trails belong to us, and so all of us work together to take care of them. In city of North Las Vegas, we've had a wonderful partnership as well, and just since starting that, we've had 1,803 volunteer hours and 14 events, again, ranging from all different types of groups. We've had a tremendous outpouring of Eagle Scout groups, Eagle Scout projects, for instance. I think we've become the clearinghouse for Eagle Scout projects. So much interest in people who want to get out there, and the more jurisdictions that we've been able to add into this, the bigger we've been able to make the program, because it just allows that much more flexibility. We enter into that agreement with the jurisdiction, we're able to lead these volunteer programs, and we are able to provide very capable folks that create a great volunteer experience, because we find people want to get out there, and the key thing is creating that wonderful experience once they get there, so they come back again and again and again, and they tell their friends and neighbors. And it really creates that feeling. It's not just cleaning up the place. It's being shoulder to shoulder with the people that live in your community and getting that feeling of ownership and feeling that you're working together towards something that's greater and larger than yourself. And we found a tremendous amount of positive energy that's come out of that. So just to close briefly and bring it back into context, through the work of all of you, all the jurisdictions, we have over 1,000 miles of trails. And so it's really one of, I think, our best, least told stories about Southern Nevada. When I travel, when I hear at conferences how many trail miles they have in other places, they don't have anything near as much as what we have. But it's really engaging the community and getting them out there and introducing them to our park loop trails, to our neighborhood trails, to all of our regional trails. So the Outside Las Vegas Foundation has really been pleased and honored to work through these different mechanisms to introduce young people, senior citizens, our full spectrum of our community to these places.
Thank you, Mauricio. Commissioner June Culiani.
Thank you, Mayor Lee. Presentation as usual, and again, thank you for the Sunrise Trailhead. We still have challenges there, but it was a great day. I mean, people were really engaged and involved in it, and it's led to those meetings that you mentioned. A couple things: trails, signage on the trails. I know we've had conversations. I think each jurisdiction was looking at a different color code for theirs. Is that where we're still at, or?
Where we are right now is outside Las Vegas Foundation, we're working with the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group. We've done an inventory of all the different types of signage that are out there right now and the different types of information presented, because there is a wide variety.
Yeah.
And we're working on, this year we're developing a set of guidelines and some suggestions so that people can start looking towards something that's a little bit more of a uniform system for providing that information.
And I will steal from France, but they have over 250 mile kilometers of trails interconnected, and it's called the Grand Ronde. And what they do is, if you get into a village, there's a designation, but everything's marked with a color code. So it's painted on a tree or a rock, it's the white and red or whatever color scheme, and that way you always know you're on the right trail. So that may just be something to look at. They do something similar in Italy as far as their hiking trails as well. But you're right, I mean, it gets too confusing if you're out there. Sometimes you don't always know where to go. The other thing that might be something that the group probably has brought up is where there is cell service versus where there isn't, in case anybody gets injured or there's a situation like we're having up in the Sunrise Hills with the gunshots and things along those lines. I want people to be safe, especially if we have field trips out there. So maybe that's an incorporation of not a cell zone, so at least they know, or the next nearest one is so far away as far as that component. The 1,000 miles, what is our potential for trails? Is it, has anybody, I mean?
Well, in terms of a limit, at this point, I don't think that we've looked at a limit in terms of that potential. We have, when we put together that regional trail map, something that I think becomes apparent when you look at it is the gaps between some of the trails. And so we have more opportunity to create that connectivity. When we're looking at alternate modes of transportation, for instance, and things along those lines, those trails can really provide a different way for people to move throughout the valley that could maybe get some of our cyclists and our pedestrians off of some of our roadways and create some more comfort zone for
dump
travel.
Out on, with lack of a better term, onto roadways, and it gets confusing. Even I take my staff sometimes when we do the Flamingo Wash. In fact, I'm overdue for that one. And it's good to see from that perspective of those that are the users what's happening out there. So I'm glad to hear that maybe the connectivity piece is still on the drawing board to kind of fill in where we don't have that part of it. Do you then identify, say it's something that we could then apply for SNPLMA monies as an organization? Say it's an interconnectivity from us to Las Vegas or to Mesquite, so that it gets on our radar when we're looking at those grants. That would probably be something that's helpful in the long run. Because I do know that they do fund sometimes, we do, and they're not doing rounds this year, so it'll be the next year that we can plan for.
Certainly we can do that. Working with the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group has always been very engaged in looking at things collaboratively that way. And I know different cities and jurisdictions have been going through the process of gap analysis to look at how that connectivity can be created. I know City of Las Vegas has been looking at their bicycle connectivity. City of North Las Vegas with this new project funded by the Health District, and City of Henderson, Clark County. Everybody's been very much engaged in that process.
So gap analysis, I have to learn these terms. Okay, that makes good
sense. Exactly. And it's just as it sounds. It's where are those gaps? Right. How can we make it easier for people to connect in those places? And also visually with signage, let people know that they can find it.
Right.
With rest things like
1 mile away.
Exactly.
I mean, you know, little things like that when you're out with your kids or whatever.
When we've done the volunteer programs, also one of the things that we've done is we've looked at grant opportunities that may not have been available to some of the jurisdictions. And then through the agreements with the jurisdictions, then we've done things like we did experimental signage work on the Cedar Trail with the City of Las Vegas, where we looked at different ways that we could install signage within the pavement itself to improve that indication of where people are, especially when a trail hits an intersection. So that you know that, because there's no sign on what street you're at that point. So to create that comfort zone and that sense of information, if something does happen, or if they do need to tell somebody where to find them, they can do that because that signage is there. So that was a great project that we did with Public Works with City of Las Vegas.
Okay, and is ADA capability indicated? Because some trails were built before we really came into compliance with some parts of that, I'm going to assume. So are all our trails ADA capacity, or do we at least sign for those that might want to get out there, whether they're in a wheelchair or no, you know, they're blind or whatever it might be?
That again also comes with that assessment of the different types of information that are presented on the trail signage. It really does vary widely and often within a single jurisdiction, and will vary somewhat dependent in part by when that trail was constructed. So what information was being presented at different times. So I think we'd like to move towards some more uniform information.
Okay, and then finally, do you get some dollars from our public works jurisdictions, I think, if something's left over or they haven't used all their maintenance dollars? Is that?
We have, at this point, we have three separate agreements with the City of Las Vegas, the City of North Las Vegas, and Clark County that assist in funding largely our staff effort towards that. And then what we've done is we have private sponsorship that's come in and that's covered the cost of a lot of the materials and additional staff members, such as some part-time folks and some AmeriCorps state members that we've brought on board to help with the efforts.
Okay, so I would just at some point like to know if it's something like if we haven't expended a certain amount, maybe 1% goes to outside Nevada, because you're actually assisting our people and not having to spend those dollars, especially by getting the volunteers, the cleanups, and those types of things. And I just don't know, Mr. Chair, how that works, but maybe that's something we could look at in our jurisdictions. So at least there's some dollar specific, and then you can use that for matching dollars in the long run. So it might be something that you could better build a budget on. So just a food for thought. Thank you.
Mayor Lee and Mayor Goodman.
Thank you, Marissa. You're an exciting leader. And I really enjoyed the trail summit. It's great. And some of the good concerns are brought up by the good commissioner over there. You know, it doesn't need a lot of signage, but sometimes you're on the right-hand side of the flood control channel, and next you got to go down the side street. You know, on the Pacific Coast Trail and the Lake Tahoe Rim Trail, sometimes you'll see something. You don't have to do the whole trail, but there are certain intersections that just you don't know to go to the right or to the left. Mm-hmm. You know, and if we had some of the basic intersections covered, but do you see a time when we'll be able to do some go ride overs, like over Sahara or over Charleston and some of those areas? And then the other one was out in the Northwest, we have a lot of, it just stops for quite a while. Are you planning on continuing to move that forward, or is it something North Las Vegas needs to get involved with you on for the whole region here?
I would love to see a time when there are more ways to get over some of our larger streets. The bridge over the I-15, I think, is one of those watershed moments when you can actually get over the I-15. That was one of our largest blocks, if you will. The cities have been really engaged with looking at how to fill those gaps. And that's something that I realize it's restricted to some extent by what funding is available. I think the fuel index that was passed, that's something that is an opportunity for creating those connections. Continued Southern Nevada Public Lands Management Act funds are opportunities. There are different opportunities that can be looked at for grants, and I think as the jurisdictions continue to work together collaboratively, that increases in our ability to do just that much more. And we are happy to continue serving as that facilitator to work amongst the jurisdictions to continue moving that forward.
Thank you.
Mayor Goodman.
Thank you. Again, Mayor, really tremendous leadership in all of this. Couple of questions. Are you working with Kathy Tull or anybody at the LVCVA for conventioneers who come here who really want to take advantage of our outdoor space? Are you doing anything with LVCVA for conventions?
I've presented to LVCVA about what I do. I think that is a tremendous opportunity.
Yes.
That we have here with our outdoor volunteerism. Often, as you're saying, many people come in for conventions, they want to give back. They want to incorporate that as part of their sustainability component of their convention. And our outdoor resources do provide some places where you can have a few hundred people go and have a volunteer experience.
My suggestion to you is perhaps to get in touch with Kathy Tull, who's in charge of the marketing for the LVCVA, because many times conventioners come here and bring their families.
Yes.
And so how it can be incorporated, whether you have the brochure. The other question I have is, do you have an app?
Well, there's the Neon to Nature app, which was created with the Regional Open Space and Trails Work Group and the Southern Nevada Health District. So there is an app for that now. and that's being improved all the time. So there is that, which I think would be a fantastic thing to share. As you're saying, conventioners do often come here with their families, and then we'd also like them to come back. So introducing them to some of the wonderful outdoor resources that they can continue to visit if they come back, hopefully over and over again to our area.
And we would like to incorporate in what we're marketing through our brochure that comes out twice a year in the city outside Las Vegas. I think it's really critical. This is such a wonderful opportunity, and we haven't been marketing it in Southern Nevada about Red Rock and about the shared biking that's on there coming and all the things so everybody can take advantage. So I think your Outside Las Vegas app would really be helpful to do. But Kathy Tull, and I think I saw Melissa Warren here, yes. And so you've just done a great job. I can't believe what's happened in the past 5 years since you've really moved this mountain. So thank you on behalf of everybody.
Thank you very much.
Councilwoman.
Thank you. I just wanted to compliment Marisha and Outside Las Vegas on the good work that they're doing to build a brighter future in Southern Nevada. And, you know, I think people just need to remember that that these 1,000 miles of trails are actually part of our transportation network in Southern Nevada, and that we need to keep that in mind as we build connectivity with our bus system and our roadways to make sure that folks can access those systems. So as we look at expanding the bus system, maybe we look at ways we can drop people off at trailheads and places where they can connect to the trail system. So kudos to you and my compliments for building that brighter future.
Thank you so much. And again, it's really been an honor and a pleasure to work with the jurisdictions and the different staff members, really wonderful teams at all of the jurisdictions and the Regional Transportation Commission of Southern Nevada, really fantastic folks at the ground level that we've been able to work with.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much.
In closing, I'm just going to make a pitch on something that Commissioner Giuncagliani touched on, and Mauricio, and the fact that dollars that are allocated to this organization are the most efficient, effective use of taxpayer dollars that you can allocate as it relates to trail maintenance. All they need to do is have a coordinator, a volunteer coordinator on staff who puts these maintenance efforts together, and you get a cleaned up trail. So they're able to do it much more efficiently and effectively than any of us would ever be able to do it with our own staff. So
Thank you.
And
I am going to ask, Tina, excuse me, because Mayor Lee has a big grand opening over in North Las Vegas, and I'm going to lose one of my colleagues for a funeral. So I need to make a motion to take out of order the two non-consent items that are on our agenda today, just to make sure we have enough here to meet the quorum, and then council, I can come back and pick up where we are currently.
Yes, let's go ahead and do that. Let's change the agenda by way of motion.
Motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye. Okay. So, Tina, if we could go to non-consent 51.
Oh, straight to non-consent. Okay.
51 and 52.
All right. Thank you.
And just for the public's information, we will come back to that point, which includes NDOT and the first public comment period. So.
Thank you,
True.
Mr.
I'm sorry.
Chairman. Are we ready?
Councilwoman just indicated we should take the consent calendar also.
Okay.
Yeah. As
so
a vote.
Your next item then is your consent agenda, which is made up of items 5 through 50 and may be taken in one motion.
Motion to approve. Motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Next item is item number 51, which is to receive the fiscal year 2015 audited financial statements. And this will be fast. Did you get that part about the
past? Yes,
fast. I got that.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, with your indulgence, keep turning it off and on. Having not been a member of this wonderful body at the time of 2014, I don't know if it's appropriate if I vote on it because I have no idea what was going on other than watching you all from the public view.
We'll turn that question to our brilliant counsel.
I'm sorry, say that again, Commissioner.
I want to know if I can vote because I wasn't here. I mean, I'm new to the committee.
Can she receive the audit?
Thank you for that question. I think you're authorized to take a position on this. Why don't we listen to the presentation and then you can evaluate it. If you have questions, you may ask them, but I think it's appropriate for you.
But it would be inappropriate for me to be able to validate anything in the budget. So
noted, and I agree.
As long as you've given permission, it's fine. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Lupita Martinez, and I am a senior manager with Moss Adams. The partner on the audit is Jim Thompson. He was here with you last year, but unfortunately could not be with us here today. In your reporting packet, you have two reports, the financial statement reporting packet of the RTC, as well as our required communications with the commissioners. Within our financial statement reporting packet, we've issued two independent audit reports, our report of independent auditors on the financial statements, and our report of independent auditors in accordance with government auditing standards. We performed an audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards and government auditing standards to provide assurance that the financial statements are free from material misstatement and are fairly presented. And in our opinion, the financial statements present fairly in all material respects, the financial position, the governmental activities, the business type activities, and each major fund of the RTC as of June 30, 2015, in conformity with generally accepted accounting principles. We did want to bring to your attention an emphasis of matter paragraph. The RTC did adopt GASB statements 68 and 71, which are the pension standards. And our opinion was not modified with regard to this matter. It was adopted appropriately, and therefore there is a clean opinion on the financial statements. Before I go to our second report, are there any questions that we could take now on the audit of the financial statements?
Comments or questions? Please continue.
Our second report is our report of required communications with the commissioners. Just some things to quickly go over. We met our plan, scope, and timing of the audit. There were no significant findings or issues. We encountered no significant difficulties in performing the audit. We had no disagreements with management. To our knowledge, management did not consult with other independent accountants. There was one minor uncorrected misstatement. And that's all we have to report.
Thank you. Comments or questions? There's a motion on the floor to receive and accept. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's very quickly, if I may, it's our pleasure serving the RTC. As auditors, we wanted to acknowledge the financial management and the finance department of the RTC. They do an excellent job in preparing your financial reporting package, and we really appreciate their dedication to the audit process. We thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. Deputy General Manager MJ Maynard will handle item number 52.
Thanks, Tina. Item 52 is to appoint an evaluation committee to assess the performance of the general manager for the period of January 1, 2015 through December 31st, 2015. It is the practice of the RTC's Board of Commissioners to evaluate the performance of the general manager on an annual basis. In keeping with the board's past process, it is recommended that the board consider appointing a committee of the commission's members to review the general manager's performance and recommend goals and objectives for 2016. The committee's recommendations will be presented to the board for consideration.
Move to appoint Chairman Brown, Vice Chairman, and Commissioner to this committee.
It's a motion on the floor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
And that will, for the record, those that weren't here earlier, we coordinate this with the Regional Flood Control District, so that same subcommittee was created earlier. Okay,
next.
Now,
item number 53 is to receive a report from... Oh.
We'll go back. This is to receive the report,
oh,
so
yeah.
We'll go
this
back
is, okay.
And finish up with the general manager's report and hear from NDOT, and then we'll work our way back.
Okay.
Thank you.
So your next item then is to receive the Nevada Department of Transportation Director's Report.
Thank you, Tina. I have some good news, some great news, and some little bit of bad news. But the good news was that Congress is working on a long-term bill. It looks like since the House 1 week ago passed a six-year version of the transportation bill. You might recall that I reported that the Senate passed their version a few months ago. So they have to reconcile their differences in a conference committee, and we have our Congressman Crescent Hardy on that committee, so we have a voice at the table. And the current extension expires November 20th, I believe, but they have enough money if they need some more time to go into the end of the year, should they need that additional time to reconcile their differences. There's some great news in that the Transportation Board approved the contract with Kiewit for Project Neon, $559 million design-build contract for improvements on I-15, Charleston Interchange, additional ramps for access to the area of redevelopment in the city of Las Vegas there by the Smith Center. And also the one thing that we're looking forward to is the direct connection of the center of US 95, the HOV lanes, to the express lanes on I-15. So Kiewit made a commitment to hire locally. They're using a lot of the local Nevada companies on their team, and they're going to work with the labor unions to hire local labor craftsmen. We have significant disincentives if they finish late or inconvenience the traveling public beyond what they had committed to in their proposal that we accepted. And they can earn bonuses if the phases of the project are completed early. So it's great news, and it will work with the stakeholders. I wanted to extend my appreciation to Tina and her staff at RTC, to the City of Las Vegas, Mayor Goodman, and the council members from the city, and also the public works staff that have been working with NDOT and supporting us in the reviews and the coordination for this project. We'll definitely be reaching out to both entities for the groundbreaking ceremony. Some not so great news. We had a Tiger Grant in for some improvements at Apex on I-15 and US 93. It didn't get selected by the USDOT as one of the shortlisted projects for the $500 million they distributed nationally. But we at NDOT, we still feel that it's important to support the development and the increase in traffic in that area by proceeding with the environmental and the preliminary engineering phase of the improvements to I-15 at the interchange, both at US 93 interchange there by the landfill and up the road on US 93. So we're gonna proceed with the preliminary work to advance that project and then look where we can find the money for construction in the first phase of that project in later years. But try to do that in the near term. The last thing I wanted to report on is the NDOT is committing to mediate between the RTCs of Washoe County and Southern Nevada on the issue of congestion mitigation and air quality, or CMAQ, fund distribution. So we had set up a formula years ago that looks at the types of pollution that comes out of the tailpipe of vehicles. But those criteria have changed over the years, but that formula was never modified. So we're going to meet with both RTCs and make a final determination. We're just asking for about 60 days to get to that determination. There's going to be a winner and a loser as far as the funding distribution, so that's why there's a lack of agreement.
I'm sure you will be paying keen attention to the discussions.
Yes. So we're committed to working out that deal. And this is CMAQ funds are just because those are the two urban areas that have issues with non-attainment of air quality standards. That's why those are the two locations where that money must be spent as federal money that is distributed in Nevada. So we'll have more to report on that in the couple months ahead. And that concludes the director's report.
Mayor Goodman?
Could you share with us approximately what the job rate's gonna be there? What are we looking for employment over the 3.5 years? Not 4 years.
I don't know if my PIO staff have a number. Tony, do you have the rough estimate from Kiewit?
For the record, Tony Elia with NDOT. They're looking to hire 300 tradesmen during the peak of construction activity, and we anticipate that there'll be 4,000 jobs, both direct, indirect, and induced as a result of Project Neon.
And to what level is that, local labor?
Do you know? It's all local, Mayor. It
will all be local.
Yes, ma'am.
And union?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
They do make a conscious point to point out that they will be hiring from the local unions, all their craftsmen's position. They're being very good. Yes.
Commissioner.
Thank you. Couple of questions. What's the cost for the Apex EIS projected?
Well, the improvements that we had estimated were about $37 million in the application. So the environmental and preliminary engineering is usually a little less than 10% of that, much less than that. So.
Okay, and then how much was allocated again for Tesla for their roadway up in northern Nevada?
We have the USA Parkway project is estimated to be about $70
million. $70 million, the majority of which came from?
It's a new road that has to be cut through a mountainous area.
It goes along with the road to nowhere that they also built, but that was years ago. So is there anything not allocated at that point from that $70 million that could be rolled over into any of the Apex dollars?
No. So what we're looking at is waiting on what we receive from the next federal highway bill, because they're looking at possibly an option where they would use some other trust fund money, not just the highway trust fund, but some other trust fund money that's sitting there that would actually increase the annual allocation and distribution to the states.
Wasn't there also, didn't we receive just a slight increase from the feds on, I don't know if it was transit money or not. It's a couple million dollars more that we hadn't projected, or is that for something else I heard about?
There's two versions of the bill, and I think the Senate version had higher allocations to the states than what they're currently receiving, because they had an increase for inflation.
I know what it was. It was the taxes in lieu of ownership of land because of the impact of 87% of our land being owned by the feds, and there was some additional revenue that came in from that part of it.
I think that we still have that.
Does that also rule get allocated to its jurisdictions? Or, I mean, again, nothing against the Tesla project, except the majority of that money came from Southern Nevada, and so we should get our fair share back.
We currently receive a benefit from, because of that Nevada, being one of the states with a high percentage of federally managed land, receives a lower match requirement for that federal funding.
And then what's the status of the asbestos and the I-11 component and the press that's been on about how it's been handled by the state or may have been potentially ignored by the state?
Well, we were pleased that the George Knapp did give credit to the RTC and to NDOT for the way that we managed the situation. NDOT has a requirement that our contractor has to have their management plan address that, and we have the air quality monitors that were placed out there. So we're constantly looking at the information and making those determinations, protecting the employees, both from the contractor, our state employees that are on there, and the consultants, and the public. So the next step for NDOT is to look at what other locations that the naturally occurring asbestos could be within the state of Nevada.
Mitigated to some extent, so that's healthy for both the residents as well as the workers that are there. And I think part of it requires just, unfortunately, a lot of water to have to wet things down, because it's dust-borne, if I remember from the
Yes, and there's, as I mentioned before with that air quality funding discussion, it's something that's already required down here in Clark County to... They have a good program, public information about don't bust the crust.
Right.
So there, it is anticipated that they just are taking some additional steps, such as not running faster on the haul roads, running at a lower speed. So taking additional steps to try to reduce any dust.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do think we should still pursue, especially if a special session is called, that some fair share allocations come back to Southern Nevada for our roadways as well as the Apex project. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor Goodman.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Chairman, what was the process through which you went to take the money from the projects in Southern Nevada to make the allocation to Tesla? What is that process? Did it go through the legislature, or is it a decision of the governor? What is the process of how that happened?
There was no money taken from Southern Nevada for Tesla. What we presented to our transportation board was that the board would we presented some projects in Northern Nevada that would have to be put off to in order to fund the USA Parkway project with state funds. So it was a trade-off to delay some other Northern Nevada projects to fund that USA Parkway project.
Okay, so it was not any funding that was going into any project in the South?
Correct.
Thank you, because I misunderstood that at the last meeting or two meetings ago, and I thought that that is what I'd heard. Thank you very much.
That's all in how it's allocated.
Thank you, Rudy. Congrats on the Kiewit, the Project Neon, to your entire staff. It's good news. It's great news. And as far as the CMAQ funding, it's not so much winners and losers. RTC and most of the folks down in Southern Nevada just want fair share. No winners and losers, just fair share. And you've done a nice job over the last few years in moving that direction. This is the first time set aside for those wishing to speak on a posted agenda item, both consent and non-consent. Now is your opportunity. Are you taking the long way down here? Seeing and hearing no one, will close this portion of public comment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Your next item is your last non-consent item, item number 53, which is to receive a report from Fess Foley Warren on the proposed framework for the Transportation Resource Advisory Committee and Community Collaboration. I'd like to introduce Ms. Helen Foley from Fess Foley Warren to provide the report.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, and hello to all of the members that are still here. I'm very excited to talk about TRAC, Transportation Resource Advisory Committee. In September, the board gave direction to develop and implement TRAC and to execute a community engagement plan to provide information and seek input on transportation and mobility issues in Southern Nevada. This presentation will provide you with an update on what's going on, to let you know that we do have a TRAC committee, and we've got a wonderful group of members, as well as we are beginning the framework for all of our committee meetings and community engagement plan. Fess Foley Warren is a public relations and public affairs firm. We have 20 individuals that work with us at Fess Foley Warren. 10 of them happen to be working on this project because it is so important. This includes my business partner, Melissa Warren, as well as our social media department, who are Marcia McEachran Tempesta and Dana Pappas, Larry White, Heather Curry, and Amy Mayer from our public relations team also participate in this. And then with public outreach, we have myself, Chris Absher, Julie Schaller, and Gail Tuzolo. And so this is a huge commitment and a very, very energetic group of people that are anxious to work on the project. Melissa just so happens to be working on a critical issue with Mayor Goodman's staff, and so she has to leave. I want to jump right in and get to our framework and then the approach. Before launching TRAC, the team conducted research on what other successful organizations and communities have done when faced with infrastructure and funding needs. The results have shown a consistent strategy within every organization that includes the development of focus groups, a diverse public committee, and aggressive community outreach. Salt Lake City, Denver, Monterey, Phoenix, and Alameda County are all very good examples of what is currently happening in communities who have successfully completed this approach. So why focus groups? Well, we want to educate and inform about TRAC and what the proposal is, and we need to learn how to best engage the community so that we have successful public outreach. The RTC is currently involved in numerous initiatives, as you know, such as the Fuel Revenue Indexing, Southern Nevada Strong, Transportation Investment Business Plan, and we're actively informing Southern Nevada about each of these important programs. The Community Engagement Program is an important step in the TRAC process, so we can gather the input we need to continue moving the conversation forward. TRAC is going to be composed of approximately 35 business leaders, community leaders, and constituents, and they will meet throughout the year. In addition to business and community leaders, the diverse committee includes representatives from cycling groups, paratransit users, a resident of Sun City, members of the Nevada Alliance for Retired Americans, and Nevadans for the Common Good. TRAC will comply with all open meeting laws and meet monthly on the first Thursday of each month from 3 until 5 p.m. at the RTC. Each meeting will be carefully planned to provide information about RTC's various plans, proposals, and funding structures to ensure that those proposals are aligned with our community's transportation vision, needs, and priorities. Input from committee members and their constituencies will help guide the discussion and future plans. We'll reach out through the TRAC members to their constituencies by various outreach methods, including organizational newsletters, surveys, and more. During the meetings, the facilitator's primary objective is to have TRAC accomplish the following three items. We want them to learn about the RTC and transportation priorities, whether it's roadway or transit, as well as state and local entity projects and priorities. Most people don't know if something's an RTC project, public works for the different political subdivisions, or who's responsible for what. We want to provide input on transportation priorities and also provide funding recommendations on how to potentially fund transportation priorities. This is one of the most vital parts of it. They will be looking very carefully at what other communities have done and decide what is most appropriate or what may be most appropriate for our valley. And of course, all of this research into the projects, we will have speakers from other parts of the country come and talk to us. So the very first meeting is scheduled for January 7th. And that'll be an introduction to RTC and to TRAC. And then meetings 2 through 5, we will discuss the roadway planning and funding. And meetings 6 through 9, we will carefully look at transit issues. The committee will learn about RTC and the roles that it plays in the community in advancing Southern Nevada's infrastructure needs. And the RTC will be able to better gain an understanding of what the community's transportation priorities are and learn if funding is necessary, and if so, to explore the options. Almost simultaneously, we will be putting together a community collaboration and outreach. And this is where so many of you become involved, because we want you to be our ambassadors to your city and counties. We want your constituents to get involved. And we will be conducting town hall meetings throughout the valley and want to include not only you, your colleagues, but also your public works directors. We'll have members of RTC, but we would also like to invite legislators who represent those areas to participate. And through all of you, reach out to as many constituents as possible to see how they feel about things. Other outreach tools will include survey platforms successfully used in other cities. That's currently being drafted, and it's quite exciting because it's very interactive. We also have the potential to develop apps. When people are stuck in traffic, or if we know that there is some kind of accident on a freeway, it would be wonderful for people to log in what their route is and know instantly what routes they should be taking to have a better driving experience. And then all of the online outreach tools that we have will be on the RTC website. Now, Seeing Orange. Seeing Orange was a bold approach by RTC to try to collectively assist the public
when they have to navigate all of the orange cones in the valley. Although there are many orange cones in the valley, quite a small percentage actually are RTC projects. The recession caused us to delay all maintenance, but also the power company and the gas company and everyone else delayed maintenance. Now they're all out there, all in bright orange. And it can be frustrating to people, but we wanted, as Tina Quigley really wanted, a one-stop shopping. If someone is frustrated, they need a location. They need a website. They need a telephone number to call to find out about these projects, whose it is, and how long it's going to last, and other streets that they can use to more effectively navigate. And so there has to be a stronger coordination between public works departments and RTC, as well as others that use the roadway and dig up the roadway, so that we can aggressively coordinate all of these projects. The RTC has been meeting with your public works departments, and this is coming along quite well. But they have to identify who's doing the work, to provide information regarding merging lanes, and to provide explanations for the cones for when the work is going to be done. They are listening, and it's going to be ugly for a lot longer. People are frustrated, but we've got to make sure that people have a voice and that the RTC is responding. Not an easy task. We try to do a lot of this through social media as well. So the community engagement portion of the plan is a six-prong approach. It includes all of you. It includes outreach and social media, business community organizations, nonprofits, advocacy groups. And we want to seek their input. We want to provide them information and have them feel that they're part of the solution. I already told you that we met with the public works departments, so we're going to be utilizing them as much as possible. When people are going to be able to take a look online at a survey and say, what are your biggest areas of trouble? And they can actually punch on a little emoji and zero down into the exact location of a problem area that they're having, and then they'll be able to respond. An example, I take my kids out to Henderson, and every day when I am on 95, I see that there's this huge line waiting to get up onto 215. It seems far too much of a problem, and somebody should address it. I'm going to feel really good if I can take my little emoji and zero in on that area and give my 2 cents. And we want everyone in the community to be able to share their ideas. Many of those coincidentally happen to be on the funded and unfunded projects list that will be taken care of. But everyone in the community is feeling the pain of this, and so it's great if they can also participate in some of the solutions. We thank you very much for being able to brief you today. We are honored that we have this contract to work with you. Your RTC staff is wonderful to work with, a great group of people, and we look forward to briefing you again in the near future. Any questions? I'm happy to answer.
Thank you, Helen. Comments or questions from the board? Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, I can tell you we are equally excited to get to work with Fess Foley Warren. They've just got a lot of passion and energy for the efforts that the RTC is taking on, and they're great representatives, and they're going to shepherd us through some tough times. So much appreciated. With that, Mr. Chairman, this brings us to your last item, which is your last citizens' participation period.
This is the second time set aside for public comment. Those wishing to speak to the board. Patty? Thank you for your patience.
Oh, not a problem.
Pull that down just a little
okay.
bit. Perfect.
Hi, thank you. Good morning. So we all know that I'm a paratransit rider for like the last six and a half years. Paratransit, Ken, I don't know if he's here or if there's any paratransit drivers here. I called Ken just out of the blue because I have a relationship with you guys, and you've always been nothing but good to me, so I thought I'd push my good to me envelope. I asked Ken if I put him in touch with the Salvation Army, would he allow them to put boxes and appropriate signage in both yards? Ken said yes. Thank you. You collected 6 boxes for the Salvation Army of notions and hygiene items and all necessary items, and they were huge, deep, wide, big boxes. So I wanted to publicly thank them, and nobody's here. So you tell them thank you for me and the Salvation Army. Number 2, Tina's office was incredibly cooperative. I had a question about the Veterans Transit System, and I now understand and have relayed it to a lot of the veterans groups. Yes, you may ride that bus regardless of type of discharge. So that's another big thank you. The third thank you is, you do not make me go to Bonneville anymore to go to the VA to do my volunteer work. Somebody find them, tell them thank you. The bus now comes to my house in Summerlin. I can go to the VA straight, do my volunteer work, and come back home. And fourth and final, in September, my lupus and pneumonia and my heart all joined together to land me in the hospital. Nothing new. So when I came out, I was on a walker for about 6 weeks, and I called certification to say, okay, I'm following the rules. Do I have to come there with my walker and, you know, get recertified? Thank you, Kenny and the staff. They said, no, we know you, we trust you. We know if it's a walker, it's a walker. It's not gonna be anything obscene when we get to your house. And that was really cool, because if I had to go to certification, well, yeah, I would have gone, but I'm tired and I was sick, and I would have gone in my pajamas. So thank you for not making me have to stress my body more than it was stressed. You guys are nothing but good to me. You're nothing but good to the community. I'm sorry the people aren't here to hear me say thank you, but thank you.
Thank you, Patty. Good to have you back with good health. If you want to come down and add a couple more thank yous, we'll take it. Anyone else wishing to speak to the board? Seeing and hearing no one, we'll close this portion of public comment. Thank you all for coming this morning. This meeting is adjourned.